Hi, well, thank you very much, Margaret, for your introduction, and welcome again, ladies and gentlemen, to the first in our, hopefully, our series of Conversation for Change. And I'd like to thank Mr. Afro Raymond and Mr. Ramesh Lawrence Maharaj, SC, for being here. I know the Hilton initially in their broadcast said, "Hope you have an uneventful event," but really hope you have an eventful event here, and not uneventful, to be very participative in this whole discussion. And well, let's start one time. First of all, I'd like to ask both gentlemen, either one, what's your take on being recipient of this award, the Award for Civic Entrepreneurship, Mr. Raymond?
Well, it's good to get recognition, and it makes one recognize how much more work has to be done, because we're really facing a situation in which the lack of information has deformed our conceptions and our conversations. So we have a lack of information about the most basic things. How many people do the driving license test every year? How does that compare to 20 years ago? How many people fail the test? Does everybody pass? Is there any other country in the world that everybody passes? The most fundamental questions, and I'm not talking about property or CLECO, I'm just bringing a very mundane example, because just about everybody in the room has a driver's license in their pocket. How many people? Is it that they don't know now? We're going to get the information in 6 months' time? We don't know when we will know. And in fact, the absence of metrics, which is how I call it, I'm a surveyor by profession, and our profession is the science of measurement. The absence of metrics deforms the conceptions and the conversations to the point that all we could really talk about is this person's shirt and that person's toupee and somebody's goat and somebody's animal and all kinds of nonsense. We're unable to have a conversation. And in other countries, when you delve into the policy conversation, you are able, with a fair degree of ease, to find the information. Okay? And I want to say something else, although I'm in the company of lawyers and I'm going to be brave and stick my neck out, like I do sometimes. I want to say something else with relation to law and how law relates to information. Transforming the conversation about information doesn't only involve legislative measures. And I will give an example of something that I was startled to discover last year in March. I attended a conference at the University College of the Cayman Islands, an anti-corruption conference in the Cayman Islands, imagine that. And it was actually entitled Making the Caribbean a Corruption-Free Space. And one of the speakers there was a lady who was at that time the head of Transparency International. And that lady spoke about her visit to Brazil. And as you may know, Brazil has had these street protests, wide scale, large scale, fairly violent and emotional street protests going on for the last 2 or 3 years. The World Cup was a little lightning point, but it's been going on long before that. It will continue. And she said to us, very interesting, she said she saw something in Brazil that she hadn't seen anywhere else in the world. And this lady is the head of Transparency, a French-Canadian lady, based in the Berlin office of Transparency. She said the people in Brazil had created a database. They had forced the government to create a database. I'm going to describe it to you in terms of, let us describe. We have to get conceptual audacity grounded in facts so we can have a proper conversation. They had forced the government to create a database that anybody can go onto from anywhere in the world. We talk about open source and open data, and I'll talk about that more later. And the impact of that on how our society operates and how our society thinks. They had forced the government to create a database that anybody anywhere in the world could go into at any point in time. It's updated every 24 hours at midnight. And you can see a line by line, I literally mean by line, tens of thousands of lines of information, how much money came into the government for VAT, for motor vehicle licenses, for building permits. And line by line, how much money went out to the government to this contract for this contractor to build that bridge. Line by line. How did they do that? Because I could tell you something, as she told us to our astonishment, it didn't happen by any law. No lawyers were involved. Parliament wasn't involved. They didn't have to vote. The speaker didn't have to do anything. None of that stuff. Okay? The protests were getting more and more violent and having a bigger and bigger impact on the society. And eventually the chiefs, the political chiefs in Brazil, called in the chief protesters and said, "What do you all want? What can we do to ease up the situation. And the people who had been protesting had the focus and discipline to have a wish list, a laundry list, some of us call it, of one thing they wanted. And they said, what we want, all those buildings you have there, take a floor and put 50 civil servants in it. Put 50 computers in it. And a month from today, we want that website. So the politicians started talking on Parliament and the Senate. And they said, we don't want to hear about that. You have the information. It's our information. It's our money. We want the information. And the Brazilians did it. It's not been reported in the international press. You could understand why. Because for certain people, it's an undesirable degree of transparency. For somebody like me, it's Nirvana. It's happening in Brazil, where a lot of the people look just like us. And they made it happen without the assistance of Parliament or otherwise. So you have to have that conceptual audacity to understand that the obtaining information is not only through the channel, although we've been discussing the freedom of information as a channel, we'll be discussing that in the course of this afternoon's discussion. It's not only obtained through there. There are other channels that are lawful. They may be forceful. But there are other channels in which one could obtain the information we need to transform our conceptions and transform our conversations. I'll leave it there for now.
Mr. Mohaj.
That's my opening.
Well, I am honored, and I would like to take the opportunity of thanking the association and congratulating those who are responsible. But I'm sad that although you had a Freedom of Information Act in Trinidad and Tobago, it has not been used as it should be used. And the challenge was really for lawyers to give pro bono services and try to encourage people to use the Freedom of Information Act. It was the first time that people had a statutory right to get government-held information, which could be enforced in the courts. And it is sad also that the professionals have not come out and assist the communities. What we need, I think, and it's what I'm still trying to become involved in, is a sort of public education program to sensitize people, especially the young people, to get them involved, to get them motivated in taking up some of these causes and helping people to be able to get government-held information. Because if you cannot get the information, or if you do not have the information, and if you have access to it but you do not inform yourselves, you will not be able to perform your role in a democratic society and would not be able to make government account more to the population.